Good afternoon. My name is Shannon Westbrook. I'm the Forsyth County Ethics Panel Clerk. It is Wednesday, June 21st, 2017. I call this meeting to order at 2 p.m. Those in attendance are panelists Ms. Heather Stevenson, Mr. Michael O'Hagan, and Mr. Charles Pollack. Clerk, myself, Shannon Westbrook. Personnel Services Director Pat Carson, acting as Assistant Clerk. Complainant, Mr. Rene Guidry. Attorney for the complainant, Mr. Don Geary. The respondent, Commissioner Cindy Mills. Attorney for the respondent, Mr. Logan Butler. And the public. The first item on the agenda is the adoption of the agenda. Do I have a motion to adopt?
Motion to adopt.
I'll second it.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
The second item on the agenda is to announce that the minutes from the investigatory review meeting that we held on May 5th, 2017 have been adopted unanimously via email by the panelists on May 9th, 2017. We're here today for an evidentiary hearing of Mr. Guidry's ethics complaint against Commissioner Cindy Mills. And I would like to add for the record that the panelists have been provided before then today a copy of today's agenda and all documents that were previously provided in the investigatory review, which include the Forsyth County Ordinance Number 77B, the Forsyth County Handbook, Forsyth County Employee Handbook Policy 20, Mr. Guidry's complaint, and Commissioner Mills' response to the complaint. Since Mr. Charles Pollack was elected the chairman of the investigatory review, he will remain the chairman for today's evidentiary hearing. And I will now turn the meeting over to Chairman Pollack.
Thank you. The ethics ordinance gives very little guidance about how these hearings go, other than to ensure that the rules of due process are followed. And I think, speaking on behalf of the three of us on the panel, we're going to do our best to make sure that happens. What I'd like to do is give, is it Guidry or
Guidry.
I'd like to give Mr. Guidry the opportunity to make an opening statement, and then Ms. Mills, you would have a chance to make an opening statement, and then Mr. Guidry could present his case, call whatever witnesses, and then Ms. Mills, present your case, your defense, whatever witnesses. And any questions? Well, Mr. Guidry, if you'd like to proceed, you can do it yourself, you can do it through counsel, either way.
Take it up to the counsel.
Okay.
Gentlemen.
One second. All I would say is if we could all speak loud enough, the hearing is going to tape recorded so that we could, the microphone will pick up everyone. Thank you.
Commission. My name is Don Geary, that's G-E-A-R-Y, just for the recording. I represent Mr. Guidry. I have come in lately, but as I understand the facts behind this, Mr. Guidry has filed some open records requests involving the commissioner, Commissioner Mills. Those responses were provided by Jared Davis, the county attorney. The responses indicated for a given period that Commissioner Mills did not retain electronic emails, text messages that pertained substantively to the operation of the commission. That would have been in violation of the county's retention policy. I have a certified copy of that policy here from the county to introduce when the time comes. The responses that Mr. Guidry received mostly are comparing two commissioners, Commissioner Levent and Commissioner Mills. In Commissioner Levent's responses, he shows text messages between him and Commissioner Mills. Commissioner Mills' records are completely void. They have no records. One of the emails that Mr. Guidry was able to get actually through open records showed an email from Ms. Mills that actually prompted someone to, I'll let you interpret, it appears to encourage someone to use her personal email and her personal phone because there are open records requests coming to her county. In the responses that we received, specifically a response from June 19, 2017, one of the text messages was from...
I will object to a response from June 19th. That's well outside the pleadings of this case. It was filed March 23rd, if I remember correctly. And we're prepared under due process to deal with anything through the pleadings. Things occurring after the pleadings, obviously, we haven't had notice of or time to prepare. So I'm going to object to anything that's occurred after the date of the pleading.
This is a response from a text message from Ms. Mills dated February 20th, within the time period.
What was June 19th? Because that's only been a couple of days ago.
That's just
is
when,
that right?
When Jared and Davis actually responded to the open records request. The information is from the
when
time.
When was the request made, if I may ask?
Probably the beginning of June. They weren't getting any responses on the time period in question.
That was something
well,
that occurred.
I really do think we need to limit ourselves to the issues raised in the complaint.
I'm going there.
Okay.
The only reason I'm saying is this is from February 20th of 2017, where Ms. Mills acknowledges she doesn't keep her text messages. She, in fact, deletes them. So that would be the substance of Mr. Guidry's case, is simply in violation of the retention policy that Commissioner Mills is not retaining the electronic communications and is therefore or thus avoiding open records requests and any information that should be available to the public.
Thank you.
In looking at the complaint Mr. Guidry filed, I guess there's a way to break it down into a couple of different claims, and I think ultimately we only have one claim to be considered today. There's a claim that Commissioner Mills violated the Georgia Open Records Act. I don't really think that's at issue anymore because the county has responded to what they have in their possession. There's some claims in here regarding Ms. Mills, or Commissioner Mills, using her personal phone versus her county provided phone. And I believe this panel looked at the policy at the initial hearing, and there's no requirement that she use the county phone. So I kind of think that claim is off the table. So I think what the panel has to consider today is did Commissioner Mills violate the record retention policy? As part of the complaint, Mr. Guidry has included a portion of the records retention policy, and it sounds like they've got a certified copy today. But what's important to note, when it talks about email messages, those fall into several different categories under the records retention policy. And the retention policy itself says it is the content of messages that controls how they need to be retained. And there are three categories under that, and they're all defined in here. But generally what they call, what the policy calls transitory messages, only have to be retained for their useful life. And quite frankly, given the medium of text messages, most of those are short blurbs, stream of consciousness, things that someone could otherwise say in person that they shoot via text. The useful life on those is truly once you read them, you're done with them. There's not a lot of substance put into text messages. And due to the way the policy's written, text messages of that nature, there's no retention policy. But the useful life is once you read them and you no longer need them, you're not required to keep them. So Mr. Guidry has to show that there were substantive business communication, something that needed to be maintained according to this retention policy, and there's no evidence of that. There's assumptions that because there might have been text messages between a zoning lawyer or a developer or someone of that nature, that they must have been substantive, but there's no evidence. I don't think you're going to hear any evidence that there were substantive messages. I don't think he's going to be able to meet his burden to show what has happened. And on the flip side of that, I think the fact that the nature of these messages are such that they are in fact transitory, the deletion of them is absolutely allowed by this record retention policy, and therefore there's no violation.
Okay. Thank you. Would you like to set the case? Witnesses?
The first thing I would do, if I can, counsel?
Yes, sir.
Get a certified copy from the county of the retention policy. This, but I've got a certified copy and I've given this, I've let counsel review this.
Is there any objection?
No, sir, there's not. Okay.
And I would call Mr. Guidry as the first witness. Okay. Would you prefer to swear him or whatever?
If you could swear him.
Raise your right hand. You solemnly swear the testimony you're about to give this matter is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the true self you got.
I do.
Please put your hand down. For the record, please state your name, sir.
Rene Joseph Guidry.
Sir, are you the individual that filed the ethics complaint in this matter?
Correct.
Okay. In relation to that, did you serve open records requests upon the county?
I did.
Okay. I'm going to show you first what's been marked is a February 23rd. Response to an open records request from Jared and Davis. First, do you remember that response? Do you remember the response?
Oh, I do.
Okay. What specifically did you request in a response?
I requested text and records of text between Ms. Mills and six different numbers, one for another county commissioner, zoning attorneys, and a property developer.
Okay. Did those records show contact between those parties?
They did.
Did those records show any retained documents that responded to those records?
They did not produce any text messages that correlated with the records of text messages.
Did their response indicate that there were no such responses to your request?
Correct.
Subsequent to that, did you receive any emails pursuant to an open records request, specifically from Ms. Mills to anybody, or Commissioner Mills, I'm sorry?
I did.
Okay. I'm going to show you an email. How did you receive that email?
I'll look at it real quick, please.
I'm sorry, yes,
sir. No, that's fine. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
I received it by an open records request.
Okay. Specifically, what were you seeking when you filed the open records request?
Proof of the date of when Cindy Mills was notified of my requests for previous 6 months of text records from December 6th.
And that email was the response you received from the law firm of Jarrett and Davis, the county attorneys?
It was part of the response, yes.
Okay. Specifically, what does that email indicate to you?
To me,
I'm going to object to the extent he's being asked to speculate as to what the writer of the email said. That is a written document that speaks for itself.
I'll let it speak for itself. Now, did you more recently put in an open records request?
I did.
Okay. Were they for messages back during the period which you included in your complaint?
Correct.
Okay. I'm going to show you that. Is that the response you received?
Can I look
from
again real quick?
It is.
Sorry, yes, sir.
No, that's okay.
Can I see that one, sir? I think I got some notes in there.
Oh, yeah, sorry. Sure.
This is an open records request for any text messages from Todd Levent and two cell phone numbers that are Commissioner Mills' cell phone number.
I'm going to renew the objection I made during opening. This is an open records request that was only submitted on June 19th, well outside the pleadings in this case, and I think it's a due process violation regarding notice and opportunity to be heard on something that was requested and provided just in June.
And we're only
last week.
I'm sorry. We're only going to go back to the period in question. We're not covering anything out of that period.
I have a problem with you going beyond what was alleged in the complaint. I think that recent request does go beyond that.
The information is the information contained during the period in the complaint. It was just recently received, that's all.
Regardless, we've had no opportunity to review it, prepare a response. I just think it's unfair to admit something that was requested on June 19th.
The text message actually belonged to us.
They are the text messages, or lack of text messages, from Commissioner Mills during the period alleged in the ethics complaint. Mm-hmm. There is nothing we're going to review and or cover outside the period.
It's just something we've never seen because it just happened.
Yeah,
I think that violates due process.
Well,
can I ask a question?
Yes.
So the original request for documents, as I understand it, was you wanted all text messages from Ms. Mills during the time period. Then the second request was made for all text messages from another individual, and that is how you obtained a text message from Ms. Mills during the previous time period?
The request was any text messages that Commissioner Mills retained. We got a blank. We made a request for anything any of the other commissioners had in response back and forth to Commissioner Mills. In other words, what the other commissioner would have retained during that period. And we have substantive text messages about commission activity specifically retained by Commissioner Levent that he retained that Commissioner Mills does not retain.
So these were text messages between the two commissioners?
Yes, sir.
During that time frame?
Yes, sir.
When you initially requested, made an open records request for Commissioner Mills, there was nothing substantive that came back. It was maybe phone calls, dates, and numbers.
You've got the records. There was a record of something done, but nothing was retained.
You didn't know the subject matter of the communication. You just knew there was a communication.
There was no communication retained. Those are blank.
Right. Well, it would say a number and maybe a time or a date.
Yes, sir, but the information contained in the text message had been deleted.
But the complaint does include some body text messages from Commissioner Levent's phone. And that was provided in the complaint as an exhibit. And obviously, we have notice and we're prepared to deal with those. This, we just know nothing about.
I would offer them for your consideration, or if you decide not to
consider. Well, that's exactly what I was going to say. Because there's three of us, we'll have to talk amongst ourselves a little bit. We will take that objection under advisement.
In the response you received from Jarrett and Davis on June 19th, specifically on page 4, the top of page 4 of that response, is there a text message received from Commissioner Mills?
There is.
And what is the date and time of that message?
Received from Cindy Mills, Monday, February 20th, 2017, 4:36 p.m.
Okay, and who was that, pursuant to your request, who was that message to?
It was sent to Todd Levent.
And what is the message from Commissioner Mills?
I do not keep text messages. I delete them all.
Okay. During that time period when you made a request, specifically in February, did you receive any responses at all that were retained by Commissioner Mills?
I was informed by the county attorney that there was record of the text, but there was no text message.
Now, in subsequent responses, were you able to determine when Commissioner Mills began keeping her electronic communications?
I believe.
Object again. It sounds like we're dealing with subsequent open records requests that are not part of the pleadings.
And sir,
I'm getting far afield here.
I'm sorry. I'm not going to go substantive. I'm just going to show there's a void up until a certain date. That's the only intention of this question.
Okay. Again, it's something we'll consider.
Yes, sir.
Proceed.
I would have to look up the exact date, but I believe it was sometime around March 3rd.
Okay, up until March 3rd, in the responses that you received, did Commissioner Mills retain any electronic communications specifically with Commissioner Levent that she retained and you were able to get with open records requests?
No.
Yeah. in the response you received in February, between, who are these messages between?
This would be Todd Levent and Commissioner Mills.
Okay. I specifically take you down, I'll say, to the response second from the bottom.
Can you tell me what date and time?
Yes, sir, we're about to do that.
Okay, thank you.
Can you tell me the date and the time of that response?
The February 28th, 2017, 1910.
That 1910 would be the time?
Correct.
Correct.
And are you referring to the text messages that you provided as an exhibit to your complaint or something else?
These were not provided by the open records request that Mr. Guidry made. At that time.
At this time?
Yes, sir.
I'll just renew my objection then. It's outside the scope of the pleadings.
Understood.
Okay. In that text message, or would you read that text message?
From Todd Levent to Cindy Mills, would you like to talk about that? Also, they have a tax staff. It won't, but I believe it's preferential treatment because Christine does not want to hire a GC. She expects staff to do a lot of work for her without having to go to Sketchpad and all things everybody else is required to do.
Throughout the, and rather than reading them, throughout the responses that you received from the county attorney in your June 19th, are there substantive emails in there between the commissioners?
Correct.
Talking about business?
Yes.
Okay. Why did you not receive these emails or these text messages when you requested Commissioner Mills earlier in the year?
According to the county attorney, they were deleted.
You had to obtain these emails by going to another commissioner's records?
Correct.
For consideration, these are the June 19th response when we sought the electronic communications from another commissioner, specifically between Commissioner Mills and Commissioner Levent, to show that there were substantive communications being deleted in violation of the Records Retention Act. And again, it was not records specifically of Commissioner Mills up to that point, because Commissioner Mills retained no records. And as noted, the records, and we wanted to go far enough just to determine a date, and it appears that Commissioner Mills did start retaining these records as of March 3rd, 2017. Prior to that, we find no record whatsoever of any substantive communications. 1 second, please.
Go ahead.
All right, thank you very much. Mr. Guidry, I want you to help me figure out the time frame. This is kind of leading up to your complaint. Your complaint was filed March 23rd of 2017 against Commissioner Mills, right?
Correct.
Okay. Tell me, at the time you filed this complaint on March 23rd, what open records request had you sent to the county regarding Commissioner Mills?
I would need to look at the list of records that I have. It's a, I believe there were 9 or 10 at that point that year.
So by March, you'd sent in about 9 or 10 open records requests against Commissioner Mills?
Yeah, that's a rough guess. I would literally have to go back and look.
Wouldn't you agree, though, that prior to March, you were seeking communications for the month of January of 2017, right?
No, this started, I previously asked December 6th for 6 months worth of records between Todd Levent, zoning attorneys, a lobbyist, and a property developer as well.
So that was requested on December 6th, requesting 6 months back, right?
Correct.
And that's the one you're indicating that you got no text message bodies, correct?
Correct.
Okay. And then did you submit any other open records requests in February of 2017 that you recall?
Sure, I did.
Okay. Now, are you active with the Homeowners Coalition?
Yes.
Okay. You attend their meetings?
Yes.
And you've been present when they've had agenda items that specifically are about getting Commissioner Mills out of office, right?
No.
All right. And who is helping you formulate these open records requests?
Nobody.
Okay, in your complaint, you stated, in your open records request, you asked for text messages between Commissioner Mills and Emery Lipscomb, right?
Correct.
And your testimony is you did not receive the body or the substance of any text messages between Commissioner Mills and Emery Lipscomb, correct?
Correct.
Now, did you contact Mr. Lipscomb prior to filing this complaint to ask him about the nature of any text he might have had with Commissioner Mills?
I did not.
What I have here for the panel's consideration is an affidavit sworn and notarized by Emery Lipscomb. Just shared it with the
council. I would object to that. That's a witness that we have no ability to cross-examination concerning the substance of any allegation made in there. That is an absolute due process violation for Mr. Guidry.
If you look at the ethics ordinance, affidavits are admissible in responses, and the ethics panel has not been given subpoena power. So it's impossible to force someone to be here, because none of us have subpoena power to do that. But it is, in fact, a sworn affidavit and sworn testimony, and the ethics ordinance contemplates testimony by affidavits, and I'd ask that you accept it.
No, I mean, I believe it implies it in a response, not in the trial. Again, that's a due process deprivation, as we have no one to cross-examine.
Substantive due process doesn't have a cross-examination right. That's
we'll criminal. Take that under advisement as with the other objection.
All right, thank you. All right, in your complaint that you filed on March 23rd, you also indicated that you requested text messages between Commissioner Mills and Mr. Thomas Tropia, correct?
Correct.
And did you discuss with Mr. Tropia whether or not he texted with Ms. Mills?
I did not.
All right. Did you discuss with him what the substance of any text messages might be?
I did not.
All right. You also indicate in your complaint you requested text messages between Commissioner Mills and James Touchton, right?
Correct.
Before filing this complaint, did you talk to Mr. Touchton to see if he had communicated via text with Commissioner Mills?
I did not.
And so therefore you didn't ask if there was any substance to his text communications, right?
I did not.
So it's fair to say that you just assume that there was a substantive text message just because it was between a zoning attorney and a commissioner. Is that correct?
Based on the other text message that I received in which it did show substantive text messages, yes, that would lead me to that conclusion.
So the other text messages you received were only the ones you received from Commissioner Levent, correct?
Correct.
Didn't receive any from regarding Mr. Lipscomb, right?
As nice it would be, I have no way to force them to turn over text messages.
Right. And so the reality is, you have no idea what they may or may not have texted about. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And that's the same reality as it comes to Thomas Trapia. You really have no idea what they may or may not have texted about.
Well, I don't know what they email about either, but that's why we have the Open Records Act, so I can find out.
But I do. You can explain your answer, but I do need you to answer my question first, if that's okay.
Correct. I do not.
Okay, thank you. And then also, likewise, with James Touchton, you really have no idea what they may or may not have texted about, right?
Correct.
Now, you did receive, I guess, a response from Gerard and Davis of March 1st, where you were given some text documents from Commissioner Levin, correct?
Correct.
Okay. And you also had some follow-up email communications with an attorney at the office of Gerard and Davis, right?
Correct.
Okay. And in those follow-up emails, you were basically told that, if not in certain instances, most text messages would be considered transitory and only have to be retained for their useful life, right?
Correct.
Okay. And that you were also informed, and you know, that the records retention schedule does not prohibit the immediate deletion of transitory text messages, right?
Correct.
Okay. And then that, I believe, was with one of the associate communications between you and an associate attorney at Gerard Davis. And then Mr. Gerard later followed up and told you the same information, correct?
Correct.
Okay. So you would agree then that just the mere fact that a text message has been deleted does not violate the records retention policy?
Correct.
Okay. You'd also agree that the records retention policy says you must look at the content of any text messages before making that decision, right?
Correct.
And that, in fact, based on that content, many text messages are able to be immediately deleted, correct?
I'd like to slightly adjust my last answer. Based on the content, there are several places in there where it says constituent correspondence has to be retained, and it doesn't necessarily base that on the content.
Okay.
So,
but sorry, you don't have any evidence of constituent correspondence between Commissioner Mills and anybody via text, do you?
Correct me if I'm wrong, I believe Thomas Trapia lives in the county, so he would be a county constituent.
Right. But what if they were talking about meeting for dinner for pizza?
Is that constituent correspondence?
You don't get to ask me questions, but you have to answer mine.
I'm just saying, to me, if a constituent is corresponding, then yes, that should be retained.
Do you know where Mr. Trapia lives?
No.
So you don't even know if he lives in Ms. Mills' district, do you?
No, I don't. So does she represent the entire county? Sorry.
Wouldn't you agree then that if he doesn't even live in the county, he's not a constituent?
Correct.
Okay. You earlier read a text message, I believe, from February 28th referencing someone named Christine. Do you recall doing that?
Yes.
And that is, in fact, a reference to Christine Becknell, right?
I would assume so.
Okay. Who's a private citizen, right?
Yes.
And that text was not a communication with Christine. Rather, it was a communication between Commissioner Levent and Commissioner Mills, right?
Correct.
That's all the questions I have. Thank you.
Thank you.
I have no redirect.
Well,
And I have no additional witnesses.
Okay, I thought you mentioned that earlier. That's why I didn't ask you.
That's, I want to clarify.
Okay, perfect.
I'd like to request the panel to consider a motion for a directed verdict. The burden is on the complainant to show by clear and convincing evidence that an infraction has occurred. The only infraction that has been alleged is a violation of the records retention policy. But even to make that determination, you have to know the substance of these text messages. Mm-hmm. And there's been no evidence to that. There's no substance. He didn't talk to anybody before he filed it. He didn't try to figure out if anything of substance was texted. He just filed the complaint, kind of blindly, and based on assumptions. But he has a duty to bring forth the evidence that he says is there. And he has not done that. And I think based on what we've heard so far, this panel is authorized to say he hasn't met his burden and to grant a directed verdict in this case. And I'd ask y'all to consider that.
May I respond?
Yes.
I guess in the vein of a closing argument, the evidence we have submitted very clearly shows substantive communications between two county commissioners. The evidence we've submitted very clearly shows one commissioner clearly stating she deletes all of her text messages. That, if nothing else, communicates intent to save nothing. You either have a county commissioner who does nothing substantive at all, or she is deleting substantive text messages. You have communications between two county commissioners that are very clearly substantive. During a period covered by the complaint, by which one county commissioner has retained them, the other county commissioner has retained nothing. Intent is clearly there. Substance is clearly there in violation of the county retention ordinance. I think a directed verdict would be improper, respectfully.
We will take that under consideration. I had a question for Mr. Guidry. In the pleadings that we've seen, we've received copies of the response from Jordan Davis to your open records requests, for at least for some of them. But what we haven't seen are your actual requests to see what you're asking for.
They're normally covered in the front letter to say you've requested this, and they provide the response. And I'll say Mr. Guidry's request went to the law firm.
Sure. Refers to a letter from Jordan Davis from December 30th, but and I'm presuming that the December 30th letter would say, this is what you requested. The follow-up letter, which was attached to the complaint, doesn't. It just explains the methodology for the documents that were produced.
My late arrival. Okay. I don't possess that document.
All right. Mr. Butler, do you want to call any witnesses?
Any ruling on the motion?
We'll take it under advisement.
Okay.
the record.
We certainly can.
Yeah, we will, Tad will take a short recess and caucus on that.
All right, thank you.
How much more we can?
Is there a small room we can get?
Yeah.
The hearing will reconvene after a short recess. Mr. Geary, I understand you have an objection to the panel caucusing outside of the presence of everyone here.
And let me say, I only do this in an abundance of caution. I probably am not as familiar with the ethics code as the board here is, but I don't find anything in there that has an executive session or anything that's not a public forum. And out of abundance of caution, I just questioned the clerk of the ethics panel.
The objection's noted. My understanding is that ethics panels in the past have done convening outside of the public. But, just speaking from a personal experience, I haven't been on one where we've done it.
Yes, sir.
We did discuss your request for directed verdict, Mr. Butler, and we decided to deny that motion for a directed verdict.
Thank you. Proceed with your case.
Give me 20 seconds.
Sure.
I want to call Commissioner Mills.
Swear the witness, please.
Please raise your right hand. You solemnly swear or affirm the testimony you'll give in the matter pending before this panel today will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. So help you God.
I did.
All right, you can put your hand down.
Ms. Mills, the hearing's being recorded, so if you could speak up so we can talk. If you need to move, that's fine. Whatever works best.
Will you please introduce yourself to the panel?
Hi, I'm Commissioner Sandy Mills.
All right, and will you tell the panel what office you hold here in Forsyth County?
I'm County Commissioner, District 4.
All right. How long have you been a county commissioner?
I just started my second term in January.
All right, there's been testimony regarding your use of a personal phone versus a county-issued phone. Can you explain to the board why you made that decision, please?
I have a county phone. I got both right when I got into office, and I intended to keep everything separate. That was my goal, was to never let my personal and my county business cross. But then my county phone sometimes picks up in the building, sometimes doesn't, vice versa. I had problems with my, I went with a cheaper phone to begin with. I had trouble. It was torn up for a little while, and I didn't have it for a little while. And so I gave out via email or via Facebook my personal phone number as well. I don't know if I gave out in lieu of or as well as my county phone. Maybe you can reach me at this number. And from then on, my personal phone has been subject to open record request.
You know, there's, I guess, a text message and some statements regarding you deleting text messages. All right, can you explain to the board, I guess, any research you did into that issue or anybody you talked to, and what led you to the deletion of the text messages that are in question here today?
I mean, I've never denied that I deleted the text messages. I didn't delete it for, you know, nefarious bad reason. I mean, I deleted them as I deleted, I get hundreds of text messages. I mean, I get them from my kids, I get them from my church, I get them from, you know, all different kinds of people. But I deleted them based upon storage. I just didn't have room in my, I keep my grandkids, my videos of my grandkids and different things. And when I get to a point of saying, when it says can't make any more, there's no storage or there's no storage to do things, then I'm in a panic and I start deleting apps and start deleting. I'm not very technological, and I'm, you know, I didn't, you know, intentionally delete something that, you know, I didn't mean to delete something I shouldn't have deleted. I mean, I think I can be more careful in the future and keep things separate, but I did not mean to do anything that was wrong.
Are you now attempting to move everything back over to your county phone?
Yes, and I'm going to, not only that, but I am going to try to, I've got a better phone and I've got good storage there because I only have county business, of course, on my county phone. And I'm also going to attempt to get everything, when I get my computer fixed at home, it's messed up, but I'm going to move, get a new personal cell phone so I'll have a new phone number. So then I can totally restart again and make everything be separate.
You think utilizing the county phone would solve your storage issue on your current phone?
Well, it'll make it where I can save all, you know, all the text messages. But even though the county doesn't have a retention policy per se, I mean, they have a policy. I'm not saying there's not a policy. You gave a policy. But, I mean, there's not, we don't have unlimited storage for text messages either here at the county.
So do you have a way to upload text messages from your phone to a county storage device? Does that exist?
I don't know that it exists, but I'll have plenty of room. I won't have pictures or videos or anything on the county phone, so there'd be plenty of room.
Now, did you consult with the county attorney prior to making deletions, or did you seek advice on how to handle this situation?
I did talk to the county attorney about my text messages with Commissioner Levent, Chairman Levent, I'm sorry. I did ask him because there were some different situations going on, and I asked him if there was a concern about an event that had taken place, and there were some text messages in January in particular, and I was hesitant about those text messages And I had asked him, because I had sent those out of my belonging, and I wanted to be sure that I was okay with the ethics ordinance. And I asked him if I, in relation to those, and I think there was another set in February as well, but I asked him, I said, am I okay with the ethics ordinance? If I get an ethics, if I get an open record request, and I am asked for text messages for this block of time, and I don't have them, is it a response? I mean, is it a ethical response, or is it a clear response? As long as those are not in on my belonging, is that an ethical response? And he said, yes, as long as you don't have them on your phone, you don't have them stored in your access. And he said, can you give me an example of, you know, what your thinking is or what you're talking about? And I said, well, there, I mean, everybody knows me and Chairman Levin have quite a tumultuous relationship at times. It's not a secret. And I said, there was an incident that occurred between him and another commissioner, and there was thought to be it could turn into a legal proceeding, and there was a note that was passed at a meeting, and there that's referenced in the text message, and we thought that it might go possibly to court, and I was afraid that would be evidence to a trial or evidence to something bigger, and I was worried about deleting that. And so I asked if that would be, if I needed to put that, or if that would be allowed, if I, and the way Ken explained it to me, our county attorney, he said that if, say you make a picture of a text message or you make a copy of it and you send it to somebody, you no longer have that in your care. Or, you know, you no longer, but you don't know what they're going to do with it or if it's out there anywhere. So it does not mean that. So if somebody asks if you have it, if you've retained it, no, you haven't retained it, but you don't know, as long as you don't have access to it. And then there was a second issue on Commissioner Levent's, that I was always afraid that I was being set up in some way, that I was being set up for this very thing that was occurring. And I was worried about that there was going to be messages that were going to be revealed that were going to be used in a way that was against me in some way.
Now, on these text messages you're just now talking about, were they more, I guess, personal or political in nature between you and Commissioner Levent? Or were they actually talking about the substance of county business?
I mean, I would say they're most of the time fussing and fighting, you know, more personal. I mean, of course, different people have different perspectives. I mean, it's according to how you're looking at it. But I would say that most of them, I mean, there's some text messages are arguments over how you viewed a vote after the vote was taken, you know.
So you and Commissioner Levent would argue about how someone might have voted after it was a closed issue.
Vote.
Okay.
I mean,
and you weren't revisiting the issue,
no,
is that correct?
No.
Okay.
It's after.
You know, in regards to some of the other names mentioned in the complaint, such as Emery Lipscomb or Thomas Trapia or James Touchton, I mean, do you ever conduct substantive business, county business, with those individuals via text?
No. Zonings are much too complicated to get into texting. I mean, they're too deep. I mean, they're too deep to do on the phone. I mean, you really want to have, and it requires more people, and it needs to be, I mean, most of the ones where Thomas Trapia was involved with the collection, there was lots of people in the room. You know, it never was just him. It was a lot of people involved.
So y'all were talking the substantive side of that in person?
Oh, yeah.
All right. So the nature of text messages, say, with Mr. Trapia, or such about making phone calls or scheduling appointments. Is that how you would classify them?
Yeah, and with him, everybody, that was me and Mr. Guidry when we got into our conversation on Facebook. He had posted this all the phone records where they had been redacted on my personal phone, and it was presented on Facebook like, look how guilty she looks, look at all her redactions. And then a lot of people were commenting, you know, oh, she's talked to Thomas Tropia on the phone so many minutes. And I was trying to explain myself, which is one of my big problems. I should never try to explain myself, because then I try to communicate too much and it just makes it worse for myself. But I was trying to say that I wasn't just dealing with Thomas Tropia on a zoning. I mean, he was helping with the beautification on 400, and he was helping with, you know, doing strategic planning with the judges. He gave them a room to go in over at the collection, and then he gave cards to the people participating in drug court. He gave Chick-fil-A cards.
You guys didn't arrange any of that via text.
No. But it wasn't about his zoning. It wasn't about county business like that.
Okay. So, do you have an understanding of what the records retention policy means? Or what kind of what your requirements are under it?
I do. I have a much better understanding now than I did before. I do understand that in the political environment that exists in our county, that I am going to have to do things totally different, or else, I mean, I'll be here every day.
Now, you had referenced some phone records that were blacked out. Were those records from your personal cell phone?
Oh, yeah. All this is my personal.
Okay. So the blacking out of records, is that because it was personal phone calls and things of that nature that weren't requested in the Open Records Act?
Yeah, they were personal. They were either my personal phone calls or my business that is personal, or even I still pay for both my daughter's phone bills, and so, you know, they could be on there.
Their numbers are on there? Okay.
They're part of my phone bill.
So, you know, in regards to other, you know, zoning attorneys or developers, like have been referenced in the complaint, do you, as a matter of course, have substantive text communications with people like that?
No.
Okay.
I mean, there's...
So, yeah, anything that you would have deleted, was it of any substance regarding business or policy decisions or anything of that nature?
No, nothing that I know of.
Thank you. Those are all the questions I have for you. Mr. Geary might have some follow-up questions.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Ma'am, prior to the filing of the ethics complaint, were you aware of the requirements of the retention policy?
I was aware of it. I should have probably been more careful about it, but I was aware of it, but I thought it was a lot more on my county phone than my personal phone.
Are you aware that retention policy in the Open Records Act doesn't distinguish between personal phones and work phones? It just deals with the type of communications that is involved?
I understand that.
Okay. You had a policy posted on Facebook, and it's evidenced by an email we've given the board today that you at least at one time or up until March of this year had a policy of deleting all electronic communications. Is that correct?
I deleted on my personal cell phone. I would delete my text messages as I needed storage.
And anything that was on the county was deleted as well, correct?
On my county cell phone, if it was substantive, I would keep it.
And the county attorney gave no responses for that period, so you retained none.
I had nothing substantive on that.
Okay. Your policy on Facebook said you would delete everything within 30 days.
Well, I should have, and I know where that was written, and it was in the midst of that of that Facebook post. And I mean, I think it's so easy to take things exactly out of context and be able to give one snippet of what somebody says. But when you look at the whole context of the Facebook post and what was said within the entire thing, if I said that, I misspoke. I manually deleted them as needed for storage space.
Okay. Any reason why you specifically started retaining all your electronic communications on March 3rd, 2017 and not before?
I started retaining after we had, I just started the month after we had this hearing. After we had, we came in here and I realized that it would be better if I kept them after we have, we came in here. I'm really trying not to text anything that means anything anymore. I'm going to try my best not to do text communication.
I understand. And you stated a moment ago that most of the time, referring to your electronic communications, that they weren't substantive. You did not say all of the time, did you?
But I mean, it's hard to remember back to all of the time, but I don't remember any that were substantive.
So given that period that was requested where you had absolutely, for 6 months, absolutely zero electronic communications retained, it would be your position now that not one of them was qualified under the Retention Act to be kept?
It would be very hard for me to say that not one of them should have been kept. It would be hard for me to say that they wouldn't be. It's a matter of how do you view, because some of it is subjective. Where one person would say, oh, that's county business that should be kept. And in this very audience, there would people that would argue and say, Cindy Mills should keep that, but it's okay if Todd Levent doesn't.
But you kept none.
I kept none. I honestly did not think that they were required to be kept.
Was that out of, and excuse me, an ignorance of the requirements of the retention policy, or because of what you thought was in the substance of the text message?
I didn't think that anything was substantive to county business. I didn't think that it was something that was meaningful.
When you want to talk to someone about a tax staff and you don't believe that they're having preferential treatment and you expect to hire a GC and expect the staff to do a lot of work, isn't that substantive?
I didn't write that, did I?
That's a communication that you
can
would
Can you
have
show
had.
The communication to her, please, since
yes,
you're
sir,
asking
sure
questions
will.
About it?
Yes, sir. Given these communications, now, it doesn't state specifically that you have to generate the communication. You have to be a party of the communications that are substantive. Is it your opinion that that's not a substantive communication?
I mean, I didn't even know what it was being talked about.
So if you didn't know what it was being talked about without understanding or even inquiring if it was substantive, you simply deleted it?
I mean, I didn't even know what it was in relation to. It didn't have anything to do with any subject matter that I knew what it was about.
But you then didn't inquire if it was substantive communication concerning the Forsyth County Commission, did you?
It was nothing that was before us. That was nothing. The issue that he brought up was nothing we were making a decision on. It was nothing that was, it was to do, I assume, with something she was having an issue with in the planning department, which was not substantive at all.
Do you believe the communications that you get from constituents or people in the county raising concerns within the county are not substantive in your position as a county commissioner?
I do. I think they are if they're matters that are before us. But maybe that's where somebody needs to tell us. If they tell me that they are, if they tell me, but if somebody, I can give you like 100 examples of things that come before us. I mean, I don't know where you will find enough storage or the hundreds of thousands or million dollars that it'll take to store it. But I get emails, and I keep every email, but I get text messages sometimes that would be where, you know, something in relation to a pothole that's in, I mean, is that substantive? I mean, maybe it is. I don't know. No one said that it is. I thought it would be matters that are within our control, things that we're voting on, things that we have impact on.
Were you aware that there were emails or text messages in there concerning some of the zoning issues between commissioners?
I knew that there were issues after the fact, after we had voted on the zoning.
And you did not think that was a substantive discussion?
I didn't think it was after the fact, after they had been voted on and it was the matter had been determined.
And again, you kept none of these emails so that open records requests could...
I just want to object to the form of the question. You said email, and we're talking about text.
I will rephrase. Thank you, Counsel. But you kept no text messages concerning any of these communications for an open records, for the transparency of Forsyth County, for the constituents to see what's going on, did you?
I mean, it was two commissioners arguing over...
I'm going to do as your counsel did. Please say yes or no, and then you can explain your answer now.
No, I did not keep it.
Okay.
And I didn't. And I didn't keep it because I didn't think it was, substantive.
Substantive. Yes, ma'am.
Because I thought it was after the zoning had been determined.
Now,
there was just one text about that, I believe.
Yes, ma'am. Now, the policy that, and I understand you said it was out of context, and then the email that you sent where you delete all this stuff, was that a strict policy that you had at the time, irrespective of what the content was?
No, I tried. I mean, no, it wasn't a strict policy. I don't have like a policy that I just go around and try to keep things from people. I'm by far, I think people know I'm the most, I talk to everybody. I email with everybody. I should have never probably got on Facebook, and I even correspond on there with everybody. But I try to warn people. The email you submitted that are good friends of mine that I've known since they grew up, I always try to warn people, not to protect me, because I don't worry about my emails being, I'm out in the open and I'm as transparent as can be. But I try to warn people, be careful what you say, because you will be subjected to open record requests, not me.
Well, private citizens aren't subject to that, just our officials. But how
would they are with what they write.
If you have them. How are you transparent if you delete everything?
Well, I didn't know. I have the right to delete something that's not substantive. I've got to find a different word to say that, but if they're not substantive, and I did not think that what I had deleted was wrong.
And let me ask, I guess, so if you're communicating with another commissioner and you're talking about some business or some procedure on the commission, unless it's something you were directly voting on, you did not believe it was substantive?
If it was something that was impactful, that I thought the citizens would care about, yes, I would think that. But I honestly, and on my county phone, I would probably have looked at it even more so. But it's not like a lot of commissioners are sitting around texting all the time. I mean, me and Commissioner Levent probably text more than anybody.
But you indicated that you receive hundreds to thousands, is what you said a moment ago.
Well, I mean, my children, my... You know, a lot of them are personal in nature.
I understand.
And a lot of them are just like short things. Like I'm sitting in I'm in meetings most of the time. I probably have 4 or 5 meetings a day. So it takes up the bulk of my time. So I might get a call comes in, I don't know who the number is, and I don't like for citizens to think I'm not answering their phone calls. So I will hit that automatic message, whatever it is, sorry, I can't take your call right now, or either, can I call you back later? And that person will respond to me. Commissioner Mills, I was wondering if I might can meet with you at such and such time, or I was sure I was calling you about so-and-so, can we set up a time, or you can call me later. Those are scheduling things. You can do that sitting in a meeting.
And I understand that, ma'am, but if someone is asking to speak to you concerning something that the commission is considering or that you are trying to be a proponent of, isn't that relevant?
Nobody said the word a proponent of. Nobody's saying if they're in opposition or if they're for or against something. Lots of times they want to meet with you just about a concern. I mean, they don't have to be for or against something to want to meet. I have people meet with me all the time about just personal issues. Sometimes they don't even tell me what they're meeting about.
Just started your second term. How long was your first term?
4 years.
In all of that time, you've not kept a single text message?
Do I have in my possession text messages from
the
past?
Given the storage retention policy, you don't have one single text message?
No.
Thank you, ma'am.
I want to ask you about the example opposing counsel used regarding getting a text regarding a pothole. Let's assume you got a text saying there's a pothole on the street.
Counsel, if I can correct, that wasn't my example. That was Commissioner.
Is that hers?
Yes, sir.
I'm sorry.
That's
I thought
okay.
You said it.
No,
correct my question. The pothole example, regardless of who started it. Once you get a text message saying, hey, there's a pothole on the street, is there any usefulness in keeping that text message to you, or do you just move on from getting that notice and then do substantive work to fix it?
What I do is I delegate. I mean, when I get something that is not in my control, I don't have the means to know how to fix it. I don't have the ability. I give it to the department that can. So I'm just the vehicle to send it to whoever can. And I'm very responsive to citizens, so I get those throughout the district.
And
I mean, throughout
that,
the county, not just in my district.
Same example, once you have delegated out, you've been made, maybe you got a text notice of something, you've delegated out to fix it, do you have any need or is it useful at all for you to keep the text message that said, hey, there's a pothole?
No, and what I try to do, so the citizens will have an email record of it, I try to, and I always do this if people ever Facebook me about anything. I ask them to send me an email because the citizens need that so they can have a record. And so I try, if I ever do get anything sent, especially if it's ever something Facebook, but if I do get like I'm sure it's happened with texting before, but that way I have a chain of something that I can show. You know, I can go back to the county department head that I sent it to be able to follow up for the citizen.
And you keep all those emails, is that right?
The county does.
The county does.
I don't have the storage. The county does.
Okay. Thank you. That's all I have.
Just one follow-up, ma'am. You indicated, or your counsel indicated, or asked you whether you had a use for the text message. Do you understand whether you have a use for it is not relevant under the retention policy?
I'm going to object to the form of the question. The retention policy actually uses the term useful life.
Useful
I
life.
I think it's a mischaracterization there.
Not whether it is substantively useful to the commissioner. That is irrelevant. So I want to understand her interpretation. Do you understand, and I'll ask the question again, ma'am, I'll try to. Do you understand that whether substantively to you, whether it's useful, is not relevant at all to the retention policy?
I mean, I looked at it, if I'm taking care of the citizen, and if I'm meeting the need of the citizen that elected me, and if I'm serving them, then I have taken, if I've taken a text message, and this is an example, I don't even know if it's a real life example, but if I've gotten the pothole text, and I have taken that, and I put it into the form of an email, that has saved that record. That record has been retained. And that way, I've taken it, I have sent it to the department, I'm getting their need taken care of, and to me, that is what the job's supposed to be about.
Do you understand that that's not what the retention policy says?
I mean...
Jack, that's calling for a legal answer, a legal conclusion.
She doesn't know what the policy is, then that kind of explains why it's not being followed. Please answer me.
Does it not get back to subjective? I mean, if the pothole example that I don't know that exists.
Then do you believe that if it's subjective, then you have the right to delete everything irrespective of what is there? Because you don't,
I don't think that I have the right to delete something that's substantial or substantive.
But you didn't keep a single one in 5 years, did you?
I didn't feel like that they needed to be retained.
Thank you, ma'am.
Nothing further.
I have a question. I don't know what the process is. When you become a commissioner, is there some sort of training that you're given? Does the county attorney come in and give like a...
orientation for newly elected commissioners?
We go to ACCG's training. And in that, I mean, I'm sure every county maybe has a different retention or text message policy maybe that maybe differs from, you know, what they do. I don't know. I mean, the advice they give you at ACCG, don't text, don't email. I mean, they tell you don't put anything in writing because it will be used against you. I've never done that. I've always been one that I email to a complete fault. I mean, I email everybody and I respond to every email that comes to me. And I've known that. I get open record requested all the time. I'm not trying to hide anything from anybody. If I've done it incorrectly, I've not meant to do it incorrectly.
Second question is, you had mentioned that you consulted with Ken Gerard about particular text messages, and I don't really know the substance of those messages, but did he know the substance of those messages? And was it on advice of counsel, like they were deleted? I couldn't quite track that.
No, I just, before I had done deletion to open up storage on my phone, I was concerned about those particular messages. There was two groups in particular I was really concerned about, and I was concerned for two different reasons that I mentioned. I was concerned that one might become a legal proceeding, that there might be court come from it, and it might be needed to be used in court. And it had to do with a personal thing between two other commissioners.
And his advice was it was okay to delete those?
He's in reference to the open record request only. I mean, as far as open record retention policy, he told me that it would not be an ethic violation if I were to, as long as I didn't have it in my belongings, as long as I didn't have it where I could get to it, that it would be fine to send it to someone else before I deleted it.
I had a question. In Mr. Guidry's complaint, he attached a copy of that notice. Was that a Facebook notice? Do you know where that came from?
It looks like it was part of that Facebook that we were talking about earlier. And I wish it had all of everything. This is the one I was talking about that I shouldn't have written. I mean, I manually deleted them. I mean, and this is...
But that is a post that you would...
I did. It wasn't. It was a reply.
Okay.
It wasn't like I... It wasn't like...
It was in a stream, a message.
Yes, and it was in a stream that had a lot of people throwing things at me all at one time.
Okay.
And that is from the Facebook thing we spoke of, sir.
I probably should have asked Mr. Guidry that question. That's okay. Since it was part of his complaint.
That is where it came from, sir.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else?
So, okay, so just to be clear on that, so while this Facebook message indicates that they auto-delete and you have no control over that, you actually physically delete them yourself?
Yes.
Okay. Right. So this is inaccurate, the Facebook?
It is.
Okay, thank you.
I think you could tell a lot more about it if you had the comments made before and after.
Okay.
It was a long, long stream of questions and answers, questions and answers. Or comments.
If either of you would like to make any kind of a closing.
I just have one more witness to call.
Oh, yes, I'm sorry.
That's fine.
Yes, go right ahead, please.
All right, Mr. Scoggins. You can sit at the end of the table, it's fine with me, instead of having to walk all the way around.
Okay. Maybe because then you sit up here so we get everything on paper.
Just so it's all picked up on the recording.
Yeah.
He'll come over here.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's fair.
Please raise your right hand. You solemnly swear from the testimony you'll give in the matter pending before this panel today will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God.
I do.
All right. Will you please introduce yourself to the panel?
My name is Joshua Scoggins. I am an attorney with the law firm of Miles, Hansford, and Talent. Here in Cumming.
And what's your primary practice area, Mr. Scoggins?
My primary practice area is zoning and land use, specifically with regard to litigation arising from that process.
And as part of your legal practice, do you have occasion to, I guess, work with or talk with Commissioner Mills?
Yes.
All right. Do you ever text message with Commissioner Mills?
We have text messaged in the past.
Do you ever text anything of a substantive nature, business, substantive business nature with Commissioner Mills?
Nothing that discusses the merits of any type of zoning action. Typically, it would be something like, is the meeting still on? Because we used to have formal meetings that were set up, you know, not formal, but weekly meetings. So we would text to make sure I didn't show up here and she was somewhere else or vice versa.
And would you say, I guess, regarding, you know, practicing zoning or land use law, is text message a viable medium for having meaningful substantive discussions on that area of the law or your practice?
No, not at all, because a lot of the stuff we work on are deals that are, for instance, one of the bigger ones was over 500 acres, and you've got plans that are sometimes the size of this table. You can't describe something like that, $100 million project, with a text message bubble. I mean, you've got to have people sitting around here analyzing these plans. I mean, we've worked on every major development in Forsyth County. Some of them, I mean, that are just massive. One I've worked on for 12 years. I mean, so these things are complicated. Even simple things are complicated.
Okay. That's all the questions I have. Thank you very much.
No questions, John.
May he be excused?
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Scoggins. That's all I have. We'll rest.
As counsel has aptly pointed out, the burden is mine. I will close last.
Sorry. Give me just a few seconds to get my computer awake. Thank you. panel members, thank you for your time today. As we talked about, this is the complaint filed by Mr. Guidry. The burden's on him to show by clear and convincing evidence that an ethical violation has occurred. And, you know, to the extent it provides guidance, you know, the ethics ordinance talks about a couple of things that I think need to be considered when you look at the evidence here. You know, and the findings under Division One, kind of the generalities of the ordinance and the purpose behind this ordinance, it talks about how the attainment of the ends of government is impaired whenever there exists a conflict between the private interest of an elected official and their duties. It goes down in subpart H to talk about that an essential principle underlying our government is that elected officials should not be denied the opportunity available to all other citizens to acquire and retain private, economic, and other interest. So, you know, this isn't a situation where just because you're an elected official, your entire life is an open book, all right? That's not how it's set up. That's not what the law says. And specifically, that's not what the ethics ordinance says. You know, you go through here and look at what's an interest that could cause a problem. You know, these are direct or indirect pecuniary or material benefits accruing to an official or employee. That's really what this ethics ordinance is about. The examples they specifically talk about regard conflict of interest, financial disclosures, other disclosures, you know, incompatible service, unauthorized use to public property, appearing before county entities. You know, it doesn't specifically talk about the policy at issue here, which is a records retention policy. Now, you know, to kind of paint a picture of what we are dealing with, I'll cite a case for the panel. This case is Griffin Industries versus the Georgia Department of Agriculture. The cite on this case is 313 Georgia Appeal 69. It's a 2011 case. And this case deals with an open records request, because that was kind of the genesis of what got us here, was an open records request. And it points out the fact that the Open Records Act provides that no public officer shall be required to prepare reports, summaries, or compilations not in existence at the time of the request. It goes on to say, all that is required of a public records custodian is to provide reasonable access. So a custodian complies with open records request when he grants access to files in his custody. You know, were this court to hold otherwise, a public records custodian will be subject himself to suit every time he locates and produces documents, because a citizen could always speculate about the existence of additional documents. The legislature could not have intended for the Open Records Act to be used to trap an unsuspecting public official. The purpose in the act is open government, but you heard from Mr. Guidry's 9-10 open records requests, multiple. He can't even remember how many open records requests he has sent. So there's a little bit of misuse of the process here in his intent in going through this. And this case makes it clear that was certainly not the intent, to make a trap for people. Another case that I would like to cite, actually, that's at this point, that's the only one I need to cite. So what you have is you have really a lot of speculation. You know, there's no text messages, so therefore they must be substantive. Well, you heard from Attorney Scoggins that for this type of work, you can't do substantive work via text. This is just not the appropriate medium. You heard that many times there's plans laid out over a table, that it's, you know, some of these projects are huge in scope, not in size and financial, that in the course of his business, he doesn't conduct substantive business via text. You have the affidavit from Emory Lipscomb saying the same thing. He's another zoning attorney. What you don't have is an example of a text message that should have been kept. And that's what Mr. Guidry had to produce and had to prove to meet his burden. And he hasn't done that. He wants you to speculate that, well, if something was deleted, it must have been important. Now, you heard testimony from Commissioner Mills that she did delete these, that she does have storage issues. that her and Commissioner Levent don't get along. There's a lot of personal bickering back and forth that has happened via text message. But is that substantive county business? It's just not. When you look at the records retention policy, you know, it talks about different, I guess, three different categories. One of these are, you know, administrative support. How it describes it is messages of a facilitative nature created or received in the course of administering programs. Well, there's no evidence any of that has occurred. There's been a text message regarding the administration of any programs. You know, the other subset of that is policy and program emails. And even though they use the term emails, I think the policy refers to electronic communications, which would incorporate text messages. But these are messages documenting the formulation and adoption of policies and procedures. The medium is not such that you can develop policy and procedure via text. You might say, hey, I need to talk to you about X. But when you actually sit down and figure out what you're going to do about X, that takes in-depth communication and different things that you cannot accomplish via text. So it makes sense that there's nothing to provide because there's nothing to keep. That type of work doesn't happen via text message. And for Mr. Guidry to prevail, he has to show that it absolutely did by clear and convincing evidence, and he's failed to do so. He didn't even try to talk to any of these people that he assumed sent substantive text messages before filing his complaint. He just filed a complaint and said, hey, I see where you texted with this person. Oh, and they're a developer, so it had to be important. No, it didn't. It didn't have to be important. You know, he puts in his complaint that he got some text messages that were blacked out due to executive privilege because the county attorney was involved and alleges those should have been kept. How do you know? Any communication between an attorney and client, regardless of the nature or substance of it, is privileged and taken out. It doesn't mean it was substantive just because it was privileged. It's a communication between an attorney and client. This whole case is about speculation and an attempt to make Commissioner Mills look bad, and just an assumption that you need to save every text message from any constituent because you're a commissioner. Now, her daughter is a constituent. If her daughter sends her a text, says, hey, mom, I want to have dinner with you, because that's a constituent, is that what this means, that you have to keep that? It does not. You have to keep it if it deals with substantive county business. And there's been no evidence that that has happened. You know, the final category, which I think is the most appropriate for what we're dealing with, is transitory electronic messages, which are messages of short-term interest with no documentary or evidential value, retained for useful life. You know, there's a lot of questions about, well, whose useful life is it? Is it an activist that sends in 20 or 30 open records requests in the first 6 months of a year? His understanding of useful life is going to be much different from someone who gets text messages all the time that might say, hey, I have a pothole. That was the example that was used. But once that's been passed on, there really is no more useful life for that text message. You know, if someone says, can you call me? Or can we meet? Are we still meeting? Which is what you're hearing from the attorneys is typically what happens. Once that's occurred, there's no reason to keep any of this stuff. So Commissioner Mills' testimony makes absolute sense. And Mr. Guidry has failed to show anything of substance. He brings up one text message regarding this Christine Becknell. And Commissioner Mills was like, what, an issue before us? It was some... She was complaining about an issue she had with the planning department, and her and Commissioner Mills and Commissioner Levent were somehow talking about it. That's not county business. It's not an issue. They're not making policy or changing decisions or anything like that. It was something that was raised that was addressed or not addressed. You've heard testimony that sometimes there's been some texts between Commissioner Mills and Commissioner Levent after votes have occurred, arguing about why'd you do that or who did this, who did that. It's a closed matter at that point. What's the useful life in that communication? There isn't any. So the mere fact that there's deleted messages proves nothing. Mr. Guidry has to show one of substance was deleted, and he hasn't shown any of substance. And therefore, it's not a violation of the records retention policy, which then even begs the question is, is that an ethics ordinance violation? Let's assume it was a records retention policy violation. You know, does that actually violate what the ethics ordinance is about, which is dealing with conflicts of interest? It's not. You know, this isn't the appropriate forum for that. But regardless, there's no evidence that it's happened. It's all speculation. No background work was done. And nothing's been presented that showed that actual policy decisions, business policy decisions of importance, were made via text. And without that showing, you can't find a violation. And I'm going to ask that you do that and find there's been no violation.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for the opportunity today. Council confuses two issues. Open records request and the retention policy. I understand what council says about issues with open records, but the retention policy, which he doesn't address, is very clear. It requires retention of communications that are anything other than transitory. It says less than 15 years. It's got to have something to it, which cannot mean instant auto delete. It's not about whether there was a pothole. It's about transparency to the community. It's about transparency to the people of Forsyth County. There is none here. We're not talking a little and we're arguing about shades of gray. We're talking black and white. We're talking zero. You have in the communications that are dated June 19th from other commissioners had with Commissioner Mills, respectfully, you can't find anything other than they're substantive. Unless we're going to raise the bar to the moon. If we want to call everything not substantive, and once it's done, we're talking about a vote. This was the theory behind a vote of the commission. How is that not substantive? How is not that not available to the community, to the voters? And I disagree with one point. Mr. Guidry can't prove it. He can't. I admit, with Commissioner Mills' communications, because she deleted every doggone one of them. That's not the purpose of the retention policy or the Open Records Act, to avoid its implication by retaining nothing. How is that transparent? Commissioner Mills stated, well, I don't want to keep it, so I give it to someone else. You know case law. You can't avoid open records by hiding it somewhere else and deleting it in your account. That is a direct violation of the Open Records Act. How is it not an ethical violation? This ethics ordinance states you can't violate the laws of the state of Georgia. That's what's done. I'm hiding something with someone else because if I don't have it, I don't have to have it. That is an absolute violation of open records, period. End of sentence. The concept with some of the communications you have there that we had to go outside Commissioner Mills to other commissioners to show the substantive communications during the period in question, because her answer is you can't prove it because I didn't keep anything. That's not the right answer. That's I'm taking my toys and you can't have any. That's no matter what I did, it doesn't matter. You can't prove it. That's not the issue here, because this is not a criminal court. This is not beyond a reasonable doubt. This is an ethics panel. And clear and convincing? Respectfully, we've done the open records. You've got some of them. The other commissioners are keeping these. This commissioner, until 3/3/17, in over 4 years, had zero, and acknowledges she communicates with everybody all the time about anything. the probability, just on her records, that nothing was substantive is zero. When you put in Commissioner Levent's text messages, during the period in question here, you know unequivocally, for a fact, and beyond a reasonable doubt, that those text messages are substantive. They are text messages which the people of Forsyth County have a right to know. It is the purpose of the Open Records Act, and it's the purpose of the ethics ordinance. Respectfully, if it's not, that ordinance isn't worth anything. Because the people of this county have got a right to know, and the right cannot be avoided by auto-delete. I understand what the commissioner said, but those aren't our words. Those aren't Mr. Guidry's words. Those are Commissioner Mills' words. She chose them. She put them in there. They auto-delete. What's the proof in that? Every single one of them is gone. Respectfully, you've got the certified of the retention policy. On page 7 defines the items and how they have to be kept. Page 20 is specific, and 21 too. Goes into detail about these items and what has to be kept, how they have to be kept. Again, look at Commissioner Levent's. Look at the open records response from the county attorney dated July 19th for the issue, for the time in issue, just that period. And respectfully, we may disagree, but I would proffer that you can't find that some of those are not substantive. They very clearly are talking about county business. They're not talking about, I'll meet you at 5. With my daughter, I'm going to have dinner. There's no contention there, and we're not going there. We never claimed that. But the people of Forsyth County have a right to know what their elected officials are doing. And in doing so, the state of Georgia passed a retention policy. Forsyth County adopted that policy in their ordinance, and they mirrored that policy. Things have to be kept. How is it every other politician in the state and Forsyth County does this, and one doesn't have to? That's wrong. The standard is not brain surgery. What I mean by that is, when the attorney came here and was talking about 12-year litigation packages, that's not the requirement. The requirement is something substantive, other than a scheduled meeting, hi, how are you? I ask you, look at the emails we've provided from the June 19th response. That's not what those emails are. They are county business. They deal with what happened, what's going to happen, who brings this, who brought that, what happened here, what's going to happen next. That is the purpose of OMBIT records, and it's the purpose of the Ethics Act. The response simply cannot be, they're not in existence, parentheses, I've deleted them all, therefore you can't prove anything. In this fact, the extreme does prove something. Because to say otherwise means that there's not been a single communication by email in over 4 years to this county commissioner that's had any substance. And the probability of that, I say, is in fact zero. So where are they? She acknowledges she deletes them. They're gone. And I will say, please read the retention policy. Please read the Open Records Act. Nowhere in there does it say if you have the storage. If you're going to be an elected official, it's not if it's convenient. It's not if you can get to it. It's not I don't have time. These are the requirements. You answer to the public, and the public has a right to know. And they've been denied that right here completely. Commissioner Mills spoke. There was something in there that could come up in a lawsuit involving the commission. How is that alone not substantive? Her own words. How is that not substantive? If it's evidence to be used in a lawsuit, are our elected officials allowed to delete that? I believe we've had investigations in Congress over those very issues, and they didn't turn out very good for the elected officials. Recall one president that got impeached. There are requirements here, and that I made a mistake and I'm sorry, I understand that. It doesn't remove the requirement, it doesn't move the responsibility. With all due respect to Commissioner Mills, no one forced her to be a commissioner. She wanted to do it. She got elected. She's got to meet the requirements. She did not do so. Read June 19th. There is no other way. Clear and convincing? We've got beyond a reasonable doubt. You have two options. If you find that she has violated it, you can, as I understand the ethics, you can issue a reprimand or you can remove her from office. Mr. Guidry has no recommendation. Mr. Guidry's not trying to go for blood. Mr. Guidry is a concerned citizen who says, hey, we have a right to know. We're being denied that right. We've got to come to an ethics board to enforce that right when the law of the state of Georgia and the ordinance of Forsyth County is clear. We'll let you look at the text messages and we'll let you resolve that. Thank you.
Thank you. I think at this point, we're going to declare the formal public hearing portion of this closed. According to the ethics ordinance, it says any final determination shall include written findings of fact and conclusions of law, and the ethics panel shall determine if clear and convincing evidence shows any violation of this code of ethics. So we will review the evidence and issue a ruling. Thank you.
Any expectation of how long that might be, sir? And I'm just asking for a guess.
I know. My preference would be to get it done sooner rather than later.
Within the next 30 days is a target?
Yes.
An aspiration?
Yes. Yes, 30 days, I think, is. I don't want to put words in.
I'm just trying to get
mouth.
An idea. I'm not holding you to anything, sir. I'm just trying to get an idea.
Yes.
Thank you.
Within 30 days.
Yes, sir.
Would be our goal. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Meeting is adjourned.
Thank you.
I think so. If you could maybe scan them and email them to each of us. Okay. I'll let you.
And then there were.
Since you're the clerk of our panel.
Is there
going to
be a copy of
the
recording?
That digital?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That
could be a very.
Why can't you run over here, Bob?
Yeah.
Audio.
How are you?
Good. I guess the alternative is the thumb drive.
When does it
go? But I'll let you talk to your assistant.
Yeah. Yeah.
I kind of figured that was going to be the response.
Yeah.
You have to ask, you know?
I appreciate it. Thank you.